with Yes Polity. I'm Sanae Dlamini. Today on Politics 360, political analyst Ibrahim Fakir unpacks the South African Constitution and its malcontents. So it is 25 years since the adoption of South Africa's democratic constitution. It is a document that is often celebrated throughout the world, but not so much in our country. Why do you think this is the case?
Well, Sanae, I think there are two things. First is that it is celebrated to a degree. And I would sometimes say perhaps to a large degree, it is celebrated in our country, in South Africa. Of course, there's increasing numbers of people who are detractors of the Constitution, each for their own set of reasons. But by and large, I think that there is frustration, sure, about the slow and lower lack of distribution of goods and services, public goods and services. And there's certainly much frustration at the slower rate of social and economic change and transformation, which is the promise of the Constitution. But many people know that that is not the fault of the Constitution itself. It is, in fact, the poor performance of government, poor policy in some cases, bad politics, and, of course, poor governance. So that has held back the slower pace of social change, of economic change, of redistribution, and of the grand vision articulated in the Constitution. And increasingly, I think what people are trying to do is that because they feel that they can't scapegoat government, or they believe that perhaps for their own ideological or other political reasons, that they must blame the Constitution. Mm-hmm. We find that there's a greater amount of vilification, in fact, of the Constitution these days, particularly among quarters which say that the Constitution doesn't reflect African values, or that it's not a reflection of a decolonized society, or that there is something quite Western in approach in the Constitution. And my approach would be to ask, well, fine, if we accept your criticisms of what the Constitution lacks or what it is not, what about its separation of powers and functions dictum in the Constitution is anti-African or is specifically Western? What about the rights which are granted fairly extensively in the Constitution that is anti-African? What about even Section 25, if we want to take the most contentious one? Is it about Section 25 that is held back the ability of a legitimately elected government, which has all the credibility which it enjoyed for close on to 20 years, what in that has held it back from ensuring a faster pace and a faster rate of land redistribution? Policy-wise, you know, there was a land reclamation process, there was a land redistribution process, and there was a third, a land restitution, so reclamation, restitution, redistribution. And yet each of those policy regimes failed even on that fundamental question. And that's not a fault of the Constitution. That's the fault of the performance of government, of poor policy, of poor execution, and woeful oversight. And so, you know, people's mistrust in government is expressed in a whole range of things, such as protests, massive protests in society, lack of participation, withdrawal from voting, and we've seen how the numbers declined in 2019. But more and more, I think that frustration is now being channeled in questioning whether it's the Constitution that's a problem. But very few people can show what in the Constitution is in fact a hindrance.
So you reference draft legislation such as the Traditional Courts Bill as well as the Protection of State Information Bill to argue that the Constitution offers better protection for citizens than would a system of pure parliamentary sovereignty. Can you please elaborate on that insight?
Yeah, indeed. Look, I mean, you know, some of the criticisms say perhaps, you know, this could be remedied, this problems could be remedied if you had parliamentary sovereignty rather than a constitutional supremacy, because with parliamentary sovereignty, parliament would simply be able to push through all these kinds of things, particularly on the nice socio-economic type of things that we want. Now, there are two problems with this argument. First is that I can't see anything in the Constitution at the moment which actually hinders Parliament in Parliament's performance. Parliament's performance has been hindered by itself and the poor politics of the parties that compose, that constitute Parliament. Because whether it be on lawmaking, whether it be on oversight, whether it be on deliberation of public issues, particularly when it comes to the relationship between oversight and accountability, has been its failures. There's nothing in the Constitution which is constraining Parliament from exercising maximum degree of power in terms of making laws, in terms of deliberating on national issues, and in terms of extracting accountability and exercising oversight. That's where its failures have been, not because they've been constrained by the Constitution. In fact, the Constitution does, contrary to what people are saying, create a degree of parliamentary sovereignty. Parliament's only curtailed to the extent that any legislation it passes or resolution that it makes can't fly in the face of one or other of the values of the Constitution. Now, no one who criticizes this and says the Constitution's a problem shows in which way the Constitution has hindered Parliament from doing anything. In fact, on the contrary, Parliament has a lot of power. It has so much influence in terms of what its role and function has been. It has been constrained because of the bad politics and poor politics of the parties in Parliament rather than the rules codified by the Constitution. So that's the first problem. The second is that, you know, if you simply had parliamentary sovereignty without any of the safeguards, especially on socioeconomic rights, on the rights and entitlements that citizens have, I'm not talking about the political liberties. I'm talking about the fundamental rights. Think about access to housing. Think about access to antiretroviral drugs. Think about access to land. Think about access to any number of socioeconomic issues. Without those constitutional guarantees enshrined in the Constitution, it's unlikely that some of these would have been extended to citizens, firstly. Secondly, if you had parliamentary sovereignty without the safeguards, even of the political liberties enshrined in Parliament, things like the Traditional Courts Bill, which in fact had very bad provisions, some of them which had absolutely no recall or oversight over decisions made by a traditional leader, or this Protection of State Information Bill, which had provisions which had far-reaching consequences for citizens to access information, to access their rights, to keep government to account, to hold oversight. None of that would be possible because that parliament would, because of its sovereignty, ride roughshod over any of the nice progressive things we like and we think these rights must be protected. They would have rode roughshod over them by saying, but the majority has decided. Worse still, things like doing away with pro-choice provisions in the Constitution, such as abortion, women's right to terminate pregnancies when they feel they're free to do so, firstly. Secondly, completely no constraint on reimposing capital punishment or the death penalty, for example. Thirdly, doing away with any of the provisions we have with regard to gay rights and so on. So much of this, even if we take away the socioeconomic stuff, even on political liberties and so on, there would be such extensive abrogation of these rights if there was merely just parliamentary sovereignty without protections in the Constitution. So these protections are good not just because they're nice political rights. It's also about the fundamental socio-economic rights which people want, which people are entitled to. And the proliferation of them have not happened perhaps because of poor government, as I say, not because the Constitution hinders it in any way.
And can you also tell us what you mean when you say that the Constitution should not be viewed as immutable or immune from criticism?
Look, there are provisions in the Constitution which, you know, which conflict with other provisions, right? For example, you don't know sometimes when values of the Constitution are spoken about, such as responsiveness, for example, or oversight, or accountability, or representativity for that matter, which one the Constitution privileges more, and therefore when you design other systems, for example the electoral system, you don't know which one of those values to privilege firstly. Secondly, you know, when it comes to socioeconomic rights enshrined in the Bill of Rights, things which create these conditionalities, for example, things which say, you know, these rights are justiciable only to the extent the government is able to afford it, or within the available means, or within the means of available resources and so on. Sometimes those qualifiers need to be rethought, because we want the maximum expansion of some of these rights. And if you think about the wasteful, bad expenditures which have happened in government, much of that could have been used to subsidize this. So that argument which says, I can understand why it was there in the first place, because you can't create these unfettered demands, unfettered claims on government, which would become unaffordable because there isn't a limitless amount of resources. That's understandable. But in the face of the evidence thus far, what's happened over the last 25 years, there's been so much wastage, partly due to maladministration, but a lot of it because of malfeasance and corruption, that could have funded a much bigger expansion. So what I'm saying is not that we must do away with the wording which says within available. I'm saying some of these things need to be rethought to a degree, firstly. Secondly, no constitution is immutable. No constitution values remaining enshrined in time over any period of time. And one has to be prudent about the fact that there are some instances in which certain clauses do need to change in order to be more responsive, in order to respond to changing needs in society, to adapt to the way in which society has changed. But there are certain fundamental values, of course, fundamental political rights, fundamental liberties, fundamental socioeconomic rights, the right to life, the right to choice, and most importantly, freedom and equality. Those must be sacrosanct. Those shouldn't be changed. But others, certainly, they must be changed when circumstances require that they do. For example, procedures by which institutions function, procedures by which certain decisions have to be made. Because the Constitution does that. It doesn't just codify rights, doesn't just codify liberties, doesn't just create a framework for how we citizens exercise agency. It also limits the way in which government functions. It separates those functions. It prescribes procedures by which decisions have to be made. It prescribes processes by which institutions must function. So those things, when they need to be adaptable and responsive to society and changes in society, those could be changed, sure.
You also highlight a very sad observation that while core political rights are enshrined in the Constitution and appears to be protected, increasingly, South Africa has moved from a society of political intolerance to outright political thuggery.
You know, by and large, I think our society has, compared to the period of apartheid and so on, has become more tolerant, right? But there has been large intolerance. You know, if you think about the transition period from 1990 to 1994 and beyond, high levels of violence, specifically political violence, and so on, there was intolerance. There was high degrees of intolerance. Of course, by and large, though, we are a more tolerant society, but now with new debates emerging, particularly about cancel culture and so on, I don't want to get down the rabbit hole of wokeness and so on, but there is this maxim that, you know, for you to be a tolerant society, you have to tolerate sometimes even the intolerable. But there's a point emerging now in society where the intolerance and the intolerableness of some of the views become so dangerous to the proliferation of democratic, fair exchange and exposure of ideas, that those of us who want to be tolerant must start to not tolerate those who are intolerant. But by and large, we have moved to a greater degree of tolerance, sure, but we have emerged and are now also on the precipice of political thuggery. You think about many movements, anti-eviction movements, other socio-economic rights movements, the shack dwellers movements such as Abat Lali, a whole range of other social movements will tell you about the repressive way in which the government has and has responded to them, to their political demands, to their political organization. But more importantly, think about the way in which, with all of the exposures emerging in the Zondo Commission, but even predating that, the idea of political hits, of dealing with your political opponent through violence, or the kind of thuggery which appears on the streets, not just through protest, but internal party factional contestation. So, for example, if you think about local government elections, and it's not just the 2016 one, but even going back to 2011, where contestants from inside one political party find another candidate who is nominated or who may be a mayoral candidate or the party believes they want to put up, there would be protests in the street. Sometimes there'd been loss of lives. Sometimes there's been affecting of the way in which public business is conducted because of this degree of intolerance, which translates into thuggery. And worse still, sometimes we find even in the protests that we have, whether they are related to service delivery or otherwise, those protests sometimes have a level of violence which is so destructive and debilitating of public property and of the normal course of the day. Now, one understands why they happen, because of a lack of responsiveness, lack of accountability, poor government performance. But much of that, if you put that ensemble together and you think and add to that the extensiveness of crime and criminality and the criminal networks which are intertwined with much of the political class. And you see much of that contestation happening even now with the suspension of senior members of the police services by more senior members. And that internecine kind of fractiousness inside even the security services, the abuse, as we heard from the Zondo Commission, of the state security agencies, and so on, that lends itself to a degree not just of political intolerance, which would be bad enough, but outright political thuggery. And despite the grand provisions of our constitution, despite the extensive powers given to Parliament to be able to remedy these through accountability, through oversight, and through suggesting interventions through its oversight measures, it's not being used. And perhaps that's the tragedy of what the promise of the Constitution is.
On socio-economic rights, you recognize that the court cases have pushed government to improve service delivery on things like education and health, but you remind readers that the Constitution itself cannot provide socio-economic goods to people. Can you please unpack this?
Absolutely. Look, the Constitution itself as a document, as a thing, can't do it itself because it has no agency itself, but it grants us the agency to do so. So we as citizen groups who come together, NGOs, CBOs, rights groups, movements in society, social movements, unions, or even sometimes political parties have done things with the provision of constitution, either to stop the abuse of executive power through the ministers, through the president, through the speaker of parliament, many examples of that, but more importantly, social movements, NGOs, sometimes even parties, movements on the ground, social movements, movements of citizens, even groups of concerned residents, for example, those who took municipalities to court because of their non-performance and then were given court orders to allow community groups to run the affairs of municipality and ring-fence those resources to ensure that some of the services extended are continued. That is all agency which has been granted by the Constitution. The Constitution makes it possible to do so. But if you think about many of the socio-economic areas in health, in education, it's because of the good work of movements in civil society and elsewhere, which have motivated change in that area. The most, of course, spectacular example is access to antiretroviral drugs, right? Then the Grootboom case on access to land and access to housing. Successively, Section 27, equal education in the area of health and education brought greater rights. But here's the tragedy. Sometimes you even have a government which appeals court orders which are given, which they are meant to do the very job the Constitution says they must do, and which is in their ambit as the executive arm of government. I mean, where have you heard a humane government where a court case says that you must attend to the question of pit latrines in poor schools, appealing a judgment of that nature? So that tells you how much that even in the formal sense, those who are meant to be the protectors of the Constitution, those who are meant to give energy and to vivify it, actually value.
So you end it by quoting our retired Deputy Chief Justice Dikgang Moseneke in saying that constitutions are never perfect, but ours is as good as it gets. Do you think that now, with such wise words like that of Moseneke, will ultimately prevail, and that over time there will be growing and wider support among South Africans for a constitution?
One would hope so. One would hope so, because it is really a prudent and very apposite kind of dictum to say no constitution can be firm. I mean, nothing can be, right? But it is as good as we get. I mean, ours frames the limits on power. It frames procedures. It gives you the rights, gives citizen groups the rights to do so. But I fear that the way in which these rights are so, and the way in which the provisions of the Constitution are so willy-nilly disregarded, they're not taken seriously, that they are questioned so repeatedly, and the institutions by that work and which have a prescribed set of rules and functions which they have to carry out, which are not. And because of the extensive manipulation of them, as you hear at the Zondo Commission and elsewhere, because of the extensive manipulation of procedure, of process, credibility that these things have over time will erode. People will lose more and more trust in them. When they lose trust in the institutions, they will eventually start to lose trust in the Constitution itself. Because as when we started off saying, people believe, no, let's blame the failures of institutions, the manipulation of process, politics, the poor performance of government, let's blame it on the Constitution. And as this assault of on institutions, on manipulation of process, manipulation of institutions, bad government, as that gets more and more momentum, and as people question the veracity of the Constitution and its vivid picture of not a utopia, but of a good society, the more they question it, the more they vilify it, the less purchase and less currency it starts to have, because people then blame all of the problems they experience because of the failure of organization, the failure of institutions, the failure of government, and blame it on the Constitution.
That was political analyst Ibrahim Fakir in conversation with Polity about the South African Constitution and its malcontents.